So as always, quite a lot of stuff keeps happening regarding the advancement of human spaceflight. For example, SpaceX just last week tested a new prototype Starship tank for maximum burst pressure, and the results are looking really good. Then the number of Starlink satellites keeps increasing and increasing, with another successful Falcon 9 launch and subsequent landing. And then we heard that SpaceX is now reconsidering to erect new Starship facilities at the port of LA again after abandoning the old facility in 2018.
And well, things are as always progressing nicely at SpaceX. NASA keeps getting intertwined in politics. And in the midst of it, Jim Bridenstine tries to walk the fine line between appeasing politicians and trying to save Artemis. But will his efforts be enough? Talking of NASA, the first 16 science experiments and technology demonstration of the Commercial Lunar Services Payloads program have now been revealed. And of course, we have to take a closer look. So stay tuned for this highly interesting development.
So last week we could witness another impressive burst test of a prototype tank for Starship. The tank was filled with liquefied nitrogen at temperatures of around 90 Kelvin. Nitrogen is commonly used because it is quite inert, therefore doesn't really like to react, therefore there is a low risk of fire, explosions or other unforeseen events, as would be the case with more reactive, flammable gases such as oxygen, and of course even more hydrogen. Plus, nitrogen is easier to liquefy because of the higher boiling point compared to oxygen and hydrogen. Now, Elon informed us that the tank reached 8.5 bar, which is 1 bar more than the last burst test, where the tank reached only 7.5 bar. So this is definitely an improvement. And this is at the same time the critical threshold needed to be deemed safe for crewed flight, being 1.4 times over the normal operating pressure of 6 bar. So this is a very good development of reaching 8.5 bar, because then we have the minimal pressure necessary for crewed flight, and of course we want Starship to reach a crewed flight capability as soon as possible. Now meanwhile, of course, SpaceX keeps expanding their facilities at Boca Chica in order to ramp up the building of Starship parts. Because Elon really is planning on building a Starship gigafactory, or call it whatever you will, a large Starship factory at Boca Chica. See our last space video where we speculated a bit more about that. However, now suddenly SpaceX is considering to build another facility at the port of LA again. Remember that back in 2018, SpaceX erected their very first Starship facility, actually back then it was still called BFR, at the port of LA.
They even built a first prototype tank wall out of composite material. Because back then, SpaceX still planned on building BFR from carbon fiber composites. This idea was later abandoned for 3OX stainless steel, as we know. Mainly because carbon fiber composites are just way more expensive than steel, with steel actually performing better at cryogenic temperatures. Therefore, SpaceX scrapped the whole facility in early 2019. But now they are apparently considering to build new facilities there. We can only speculate on what SpaceX has planned. But it's always good to have more than one Starship factory. So having one factory at Boca Chica and another one at the port of LA would actually make sense. We will certainly keep a close eye on these developments. And meanwhile, Starlink is progressing nicely, with last week's Falcon 9 launch delivering another batch of Starlink satellites to orbit, increasing the number of active Starlink satellites to 240. If they keep up the launch schedule like this, which we think they will, Starlink will really start to provide internet service in the US and Canada by the end of 2020. Unbelievable, but true. SpaceX is already now the largest satellite operator in the world. And there will be thousands upon thousands more Starlink satellites up there in the upcoming years. And of course, a lot of FUD is being written again on that topic by our beloved mainstream news media. On the one hand, it's really funny to read these headlines, but on the other hand, they are quite annoying. The fact is that currently there are already around 5,000 satellites in orbit, not counting the new Starlink satellites. But the real problem is space debris. There are estimated to be over 128 million pieces of space debris smaller than 1 centimeter as of January 2019, with 900,000 more pieces ranging from 1 to 10 centimeters, and a staggering 34,000 large pieces of debris larger than 10 centimeters. So there's a lot of junk up there already. The maximum number of 42,000 Starlink satellites are much more benign than the space debris because they have perfectly calculated orbits so that we always know exactly where they are at any moment in time, contrary to space debris that has totally different orbits that can go all over the place.
But of course, the issue of space debris is extremely important and has to be solved one day, and ESA's Clear Space mission is a small step into that direction. The Clear Space 1 mission will launch in 2025 and will demonstrate the targeted deorbiting of space debris. Now, we hope to see more and more missions of such a nature be launched in the next years because this is an extremely important topic. Because if we don't manage to clean this mess up, it might become very dangerous, and in the most extreme scenario, even leading to the famous Kessler syndrome, where the debris would collide more and more, leading to a chain reaction of ever more and more debris, thus blocking us entirely someday from being able to reach space. If something like this, God forbid, were to happen, it would basically be insta-death for humanity. Like insta-death. So we should really get cleanup missions going, and we also hope to see more and more startups like the cool company Ocean Cleanup, but not for the ocean this time, but for space. In last week's space episode, we also talked about this cool new NASA authorization bill with the amazing name HR 5666, which hopefully never will get signed because it can clearly be seen by the name alone that this is the work of the devil. So last week on January 29th, there was a subcommittee hearing on this bill. Now, we were ranting about this bill in the last video, but Jim Bridenstine apparently also didn't like the bill so much. In his statement posted to NASA's website on January 27th, he said that he was concerned by the bill's directive that the human lander system for the Artemis moon program would be fully government-owned and directed. He called this approach ineffective since it would limit participation by commercial partners, which he has assessed 100% correctly, but we of course know why the lunar lander in this bill should be 100% government-owned and directed, don't we? Of course, so that our beloved ineffective companies such as Boeing or Lockheed can build the lander and therefore exclude all commercial partners in the process. And as we know them, they will only need 8 years and $50 billion to show us the first prototype, and then they have to test it for another 10 years until maybe it is launched at some point. And he also didn't like the idea of going to the moon slower, possibly as late as 2028 in this new bill. He said we need to go there fast or else the program would get cancelled again, which is again 100% correct. But maybe his words were a bit too aggressive, so therefore he played it like a good tactical politician again after the hearing when he tweeted, "Artemis added to NASA authorization bill. Thank you, Representative Crist and Representative Posey. And I'm at the House NASA authorization markup. Chairwoman Horn, this bipartisan bill is not a rejection of Artemis and NASA can go to the moon before 2028. Thank you, Chairwoman Horn." Suddenly not so aggressive anymore, right? Poor Jim, we wouldn't want to be him. He probably has one of the most difficult jobs on this planet, trying to walk the fine line between politics and getting things done at NASA. We have to say he's doing a quite good job so far, and we hope that this bill from hell, with Boeing as the devil, will never get signed and will be sent back into the dark abyss from whence it came.
You cannot pass! Shall not pass!
On a more positive note, the first 16 science experiments and technology demonstrations of the Commercial Lunar Services Payloads program have now been revealed. They will be carried out by two commercial lunar landers in 2021, one from the company Astrobotic with their Peregrine lander, and the other, the Nova C lander from the company Intuitive Machines. We like Intuitive Machines more, because they
have chosen wisely.
Namely a Falcon 9 to send their lander to the moon, while Astrobotic
chose poorly.
Namely the ULA Vulcan Centaur rocket. Some of the interesting science experiments are, for example, the stereo cameras for the lunar plume surface studies, or short, scalps on the Nova C lander, which will capture video and still image data of the lander's plume, which is critical for future lunar and Mars vehicle designs. This might indeed provide useful data on, for example, how a starship would actually land on the moon in the future. Because as we know, this giant behemoth is quite powerful. The Raptor engines blasting out exhaust at very high speeds, high enough for lunar regolith to actually reach escape velocity and to be blasted into space. Maybe the scalps experiment will contribute further knowledge on how to actually build heavy lunar landers, of which Starship would of course be the heaviest, in order to minimize the impact on lunar regolith. Then on the Peregrine lander, we have, for example, a neutron spectrometer system, which will search for indications of water ice and determine the amount of neutron radiation at the lunar surface, which is of course extremely important for setting better radiation limits for future astronauts, and also how long they would be allowed to stay and work on the lunar surface. Now, of course, we all know that the radiation on the moon is too damn high, with 438 millisievert per year, so 1.2 millisievert per day. On Earth, by the way, we have a nice comfortable 3 millisievert per year, 146 times lower than on the moon. So yeah, radiation definitely will be an issue. That's why we keep advocating underground bases on the moon and Mars like crazy zealots all the time. And of course, we will write down the link to all 16 science experiments into the description of this video.
So first of all, we wanted to let you know that we are considering a name change for the channel because apparently Jixuan doesn't have the easiest name in the world. We already put up a poll in the community tab and we would be extremely glad if you could participate. Alternatively, you can write us in the comment section if you have any other suggestions regarding the name for this channel.
We would really appreciate your help. And what do you say to the wonderful progress at SpaceX? So 8.5 bar burst pressure is really nice, right?
It's wonderful. 8.5.
And what would you do if you were in Jim Bridenstine's position? I wouldn't want to be in that position, I would say.
No, it's really difficult. So then we would be glad if you would subscribe, of course, and turn on the notification bell, because we upload 2 videos per week on topics of spaceflight, electric cars, and other disruptive technologies. See you!